All right, happy Sabbath, everyone. I hope everybody had a blessed week. Most of us are familiar with this quote: those who do not learn history are doomed to repeat it. But as a Christian, I believe that if we learn history and learn what could happen again, we will not be doomed, but we will be blessed. Today I would like to talk about the Waldenses, also known as the Israel of the Alps. There is a video produced by Adventists called the Israel of the Alps, and I'm efforting getting everybody a copy of this. It's an excellent resource. I use this, what I'm going to share to you today, and I also use some books that I found. And if you're familiar with the Waldenses, hopefully maybe I can share a little more light. Because what I'd like to do is I'd like to look at the parallels of the Waldenses and our church today. And I think there's a lot that we can learn, and history can teach us what it could possibly happen to us in the future. So before we begin, why don't we pray one more time and ask the Holy Spirit to be with us. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for your love and mercy, Lord. I thank you for this opportunity to share the history of the Waldensian people. And I pray that the Holy Spirit will be here in this room and will bring us a greater understanding of what happened to them and what could possibly happen to us. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So, on Paul's final journey, it took him to Rome. And when he was in Rome, he was there for 2 years in an apartment, and he was allowed to write. And as he wrote letters and awaited his fate, you know, many Christians were converted. Many people were converted to Christianity. And before Paul's death, he wrote... Oh, Mark, are we going to be able... Can I lower this down? It looks like maybe some of my slides will be cut off. He wrote in 2 Timothy 4, 7, 8, and now this is before his death. He says, "I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith." So that kind of... Paul is summing up his life. Remember, Paul didn't start off as a Christian, did he? Paul started off as Saul, the persecutor of the Christians, and God transformed his life. And he says, "I kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day." Is that a wonderful promise that you think Paul held on to as he went through his journeys, as he went through his struggles? Absolutely. And there's an encouragement for us as well. "And not me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing." So there was a promise and an encouragement for people that Paul is waiting for that crown. But he says, you know what, there's a crown for you as well if you do what I did, which is keep the faith. Now, the Waldensian people are in Italy, and they trace their roots back. Henry Arnaud was a Waldensian pastor, and he says the Vaudois are in fact descended from those refugees from Italy who, after St. Paul had there preached the gospel. So these are people that had heard the message of Paul in Rome. It says, "where they have to this day handed down the gospel from father to son in the same purity and simplicity as it was preached by St. Paul." So the Waldensian people trace their history back to the words of Paul that they were taught. And in fact, the history of the Waldenses says they trace their origin to the first dawn of revelation, which they received from the apostles, who got it obviously straight from Christ himself. So Paul was killed by Nero And in fact, Nero died the exact same year that Paul died. And so these are the Roman people, Roman emperors who persecuted God's people throughout the day. And we get down to 305. And then we come to this situation where the persecution was sport for the Roman citizens. To take Christians and put them up and the things they did, it was pretty horrible. The saints, they suffered for their faith. Like the verse that my daughter shared with you, Jesus says that if I am persecuted, then you will as well. So the people, for their faith, they died in horrible ways. So then in about 330, we have this Roman emperor, Constantine, had a vision. In the vision, he saw a cross in the sky and the words, "By this symbol you will conquer." He saw this as proof of the power of Christ and the superiority of the Christian religion. He had a dream that night, the very same thing. So this Roman emperor was apparently converted by what he saw and what he heard. When Constantine married paganism and Christianity. So Constantine was a pagan worshiper, and now he had this conversion to Christianity, but instead of going to the pure word, he kind of combined the two religions, the two faiths. And we see here, and this was shared before, but when Constantine married paganism and Christianity, the door was opened for false doctrine to creep into the early Christian church, and they were gradually introduced into the system. The church became divided into the Catholic Church, who accepted the pagan doctrines, and the true Christian church, who resisted Constantine's indoctrination. So you can see here all these false things. The year they came into, they were accepted into the Catholic Church. It says here, "We do not find anywhere in the writing of the Old Testament that the light of truth and of the holiness was at any time completely extinguished." And I was asking my wife, so it says here, "There have always been men who walked faithfully in the path of righteousness. Their numbers have been reduced." So God allowed his message to go, even though maybe there weren't very many. And can you think of a time in the world's history that the number was reduced to one faithful person? It was Noah. Not only was it was reduced to one, right? But God builds it up. It says there has never been altogether lost. The true message of God. So this is the area that we're talking about, the Waldensian Valley. It's found up in the area where the Alps are. So if you look at Turin up in the corner, on the far left corner by France, that is the area of the Waldensian Valley. And it says the apostles of Christ planted seeds of Christianity. So you have these missionaries that went from Rome, where Paul was. Paul preached his message, and missionaries took that message up. And this is kind of an aerial view of what the Alps looks like, right? The Alps goes through several countries. And I don't know if you've ever been to the Alps, but Ellen White talks about the Alps. God has provided for his people, and I'm going to quote a lot from The Great Controversy. Ellen White talks about the Waldensian people in chapter 4 of The Great Controversy. And she says, "God has provided for his people a sanctuary of awful grandeur." So she's talking about the valley where the Waldenses are is surrounded by these wonderful, incredible mountains, befitting the mighty truths committed to their trust. To those faithful exiles, the mountains were an emblem of the immutable righteousness of Jehovah. So the mountains represented God and his word, that they were solid, that they were towering. They pointed their children to the heights. So the Waldensian people, they're pointing their children to the heights, towering above them in unchanging majesty, and spoke to them of him whom there is no variableness nor shadow of turning, whose word is as enduring as the everlasting hills. So the mountains represented the rock. And who is the rock? Jesus is the rock. His word is rock solid. It doesn't change. Even from the time Paul was preaching through history to us today, God's word does not change. So I've added some pictures. These are the Alps in northern Italy. These are the mountains that they looked at that were an object lesson to them about God's word and the rock. And it's just beautiful, right? It's gorgeous. And you know, if I'm trying to look at parallels between us, do we not also have mountains in our area that we can look at that are not also impressive? We look at the Olympic Mountains and we look at the Cascade Mountains, and on a crisp sunny blue, when it's just blue sky, the mountains are just incredible, aren't they? And your minds could go also to and look and say that these also represent the rock. The Waldensian people were known as the people of the book. Scripture is what embodied the faith of the Waldensians. Are we not also called the people of the book? You know, these Bibles, this is the Bible de Vaudois. It was handwritten. That's incredible. Does anybody here have such nice handwriting that they could write a Bible? I mean, it's just an incredible thing. But they were people of the Bible. In this history of the church in the wilderness, it says that the Waldensian pastors and teachers were well trained to refute the reproach sometimes cast on them. And it says the Vaudois people had pastors of great learning versed in the languages of the Holy Scripture. So the people of the Waldensian people, they ignored what was coming out of Rome. They ignored the traditions. They ignored the holidays. They only focused on the Word of God. Uh-oh. What did I do? Okay. Okay, thank you. I'll be more careful now. All right. So, the Vaudois people had pastors of great learning versed in language of the Holy Spirit. They were truly shepherds to the people, sharing only the message found in the Word of God. The spirit of prophecy tells us that the religious belief of the Waldenses was founded upon the written Word of God, the true system of Christianity. Ultimately, what is a Christian? A Christian is a follower of Christ, right? So we are following the teachings of Jesus. Their religious belief was the inheritance of their fathers. You know, we as parents, you know, we must pass down the faith to our children. They must inherit the truth. So the great controversy, it says, far from the monuments of human pomp and pride. So this is away from the cathedrals, away from the buildings that you find down in Rome, that they use so much money and stuff to build. The people assembled, not in magnificent churches or grand cathedrals, but beneath the shadow of the mountains in the Alpine valleys. So what a Sabbath that would be, right? And it is the Sabbath, because they say here, the Waldenses of the Alps who kept the Saturday for the Lord's Day. But you know, why wouldn't they? If they're following the Word of God, if you just look in the Bible, you will never find Sunday as God's holy day. So they kept the Sabbath. It says here, going back to Judaism was considered by Roman Catholic Church as one of the most serious heresies. So they considered the Saturday Sabbath as something that was from the Jewish people, right? But I have to ask you, were Adam and Eve Jews? No. And the Sabbath was part of creation. So the Sabbath is not a Jewish thing. It's a creation thing. It says, punishable with death. And anyone of all familiar with the tactics of the Romanists knows that it has been a practice only too common among them to blacken the character of those whom they would destroy so as to justify their destruction. Does that sound familiar to us? Is that something that maybe could happen for us? Absolutely. But what does Jesus say? Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you. How? Falsely. Falsely. So what happened to the Waldenses, if they had the word of God and the words of Jesus, they would know that people are going to lie about you, lie about your faith. But what does God say? Wow, it's a blessing. Blessed. Because we're doing it for whose sake? For our sake? No. For Jesus says, for my sake, right? I'm going through these kind of quick. I have a lot. There's a lot of information. I would be happy to share my PowerPoint presentation with you. Maybe I can email it to you or something. If you have any questions, just ask me. But I don't want to keep you here until 2 o'clock, which I probably could. But I'm going through these maybe a little quickly, but I have a lot of information. So the spirit of prophecy says, pure, simple, and fervent was the piety of these followers of Christ. The principles of truth they valued. You know, we as Christians should be very principled people, shouldn't we? We should have principles, not founded on the word or world, but founded on what?
The word.
So the principles and truth they valued, this is value to them. The words of God had great value to the Waldensian people. And they valued it above houses and lands, friends, kindred, and even life itself. These principles they earnestly sought to impress upon the hearts of the young. From earliest childhood, the youth were instructed in the scriptures and taught to sacredly regard the claims of the law. So I want to talk about children just for a moment. And I want to look at the Waldenses and how they raise their children. The Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go. And when he is old, he will not depart from it. Does God value children?
Yes.
Absolutely. God loves children. And God blesses some of us with children, and we have a sacred duty to those children. Amen. This is a children's book about Paula the Waldensian. It says, parents, tender and affectionate as they were, love their children too wisely to accustom them to self-indulgence. Before them was a life and trial of hardship, perhaps a martyr's death. They were educated from childhood to endure hardness, to submit to control, and yet to think and act for themselves. You know, parents, the Waldensian parents did not sugarcoat what they believed. They did not sugarcoat what could happen to them. They raised them up to be obedient to the word of God. Ellen White says in Child Guidance, it is in the home that the education of the child is to begin. Here is his or her what? First school. The educational influence of the home are a decided power for good or for what?
Evil.
Evil. That's right. This is a quote. I don't know if you've heard this before. Mother is the name for God on the lips and hearts of little children. You know, little kids, we can teach them about Jesus and we can teach them about God. But when my four-year-old scrapes his knee, who's he going to?
Mom.
Mommy. He's going to mommy, right? That's why Ellen White says in this book, Mother's Position and Responsibility, the world needs mothers who are mothers not merely in name, but in every sense of the word. We may safely say that the distinctive duties of women are more sacred, more holy than those of men. Let women realize the sacredness of her work and in the strength and fear of God, take up her life mission. Let her educate her children for usefulness in this world and for a home in the better world. What is that better world? Heaven. Let's prepare our children to go to heaven, right? So the Waldensians took the responsibility of raising their children, like Ellen White says, it's a life mission. So let's talk about their life. So we're talking, the Waldensians lived up in the valleys below the Alps in northern Italy. And they had vineyards, they had orchards, they had fields, they had sheep. And they probably read in Genesis 3:17 where God talks about, he cursed is the ground for thy sake. Now, is this telling us that work is actually good for us? Absolutely. Work is good for us. Before the fall, food was probably abundant. You didn't have to do anything. But after the fall, God cursed the ground. We would now have to work for our food. What is God's system for feeding people? His welfare system is, if you don't work the land, you don't eat. Right? It's not quite that way for us today, but the Waldensians, they worked very hard. And even Paul understood the need to work, right? It says here in Education, page 66, the greatest of human teachers, Paul accepted the lowliest as well as the highest duties. He recognized the necessity of labor for the hand as well as for the mind. And he wrought at a handicraft for his own support, his trade of tent making. So what was Paul's day job? He was a tent maker, right? He pursued while daily preaching the gospel in the great centers of civilization. And then Paul says in Acts 20:34, these hands, he said, at parting with the elders of Ephesus, have ministered unto my necessities and to them that were with me. So even Paul, the apostle, knew the importance. The spirit of prophecy tells us the Waldenses had sacrificed their worldly prosperity for truth's sake. Is that not what we're called to do today? We're not to seek worldly prosperity. We're to be rich in the knowledge of God, right? We are to be, where's our treasure to be laid up? In heaven, that's right. And with persevering patience, they toiled for their bread. Persevering patience, they toiled for their bread. They were taught that God designs life to be a discipline and that their wants could be supplied only by personal labor, by forethought, care, and faith. The process was laborious and wearisome, but it was wholesome. You know, I like that. I should have highlighted that better, but I really like that. That really resonates with me. The process was laborious and wearisome, but it was wholesome. It was good work. It was hard work, but it was wholesome work, right? Just what man needs in his fallen state. The school which God has provided for his training and development. So it was a blessing for them. And what I liked is the Waldensian people, they mixed their life, their work with their faith. It went hand in hand, right? In Luke 10:2, it says, "Then he said to them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest." So not only were the Waldensian people faithful, but they had a message. And they wanted to share the message. I wrote down here, they felt that God required more of them than merely to preserve the truth in purity. Right? So they had more of a duty not just to preserve it for themselves and their churches, that they had a solemn responsibility to let their light shine forth to those that were in darkness. So what the Waldensians would do is they would, they went as merchants. So usually it was an older man and a younger boy, and they would go out together and they would have products, right? And they would be like door-to-door salesmen. So they would have all these things. And it says here they carried silks, jewelry, and other articles at the time not easily purchasable, save at distant marts. So they would get things that people could only buy maybe if they were in the city. So they would go out and they were welcomed as merchants. They were welcomed into these towns because they had something to sell. But what they would do is they would write down scripture. And if people's hearts were open to it, they would share it with them. Because at this time, most people in Italy were Catholic. And it was against the law for you to have a Bible. It was against the law for you to have the Word of God. So what these missionaries were giving these people was something very valuable. I shared this before. Preach the gospel at all times, and if necessary, use words. We are all missionaries, but we need to share the gospel with our actions. You know, you can be at work, whatever your job is, or at school, and you can share the gospel, and you don't even have to say anything. Is that right? It's your actions, it's your mannerisms that can reflect Christ. It says, "But of those who resisted the encroachments of the papal power, the Waldensians stood foremost." So, as the Waldensians lived in this valley, as they worshiped God by the word, the Roman church was growing. They were getting more powerful. In the very land where popery had fixed its seat. So where is the capital of the Roman Catholic Church? It's in Rome, right? Were the Waldensians very far from Rome? No, they were not. They were in the shadow of Rome, right? For centuries, the churches of the Piedmont, now the Piedmont is one of the valleys that where the Waldensians lived. The churches of the Piedmont maintained their independence. So for a long time, the Waldensians were allowed to worship as they pleased, to worship on the Sabbath, to keep the health message, to do all these wonderful things. But after a time, and I highlighted this, but the time came at last when Rome insisted upon their submission. So they were allowed to worship as they please, but then the time came when Rome said what? No more. No more. So let's just do a real quick review of the Waldensian people. They love Christ. They had the pure doctrine. And what I mean pure is they had the Bible. They were Bible-believing people. If it wasn't in here, they didn't have to do it. They were Sabbath keepers. They had the health message. They kept the Levitical health laws. They were missionaries. They understood the importance of prayer, and they held on to the promises of God. So is it a stretch for me to say that our church and the Waldensians are very similar? Very similar, right? Spirit of prophecy tells us the Waldenses were the first of all the peoples of Europe to obtain a translation of the scripture. So they had the Bible long before anybody else. And what they discovered is they declared the Church of Rome to be the apostate Babylon of the apocalypse. And at the peril of their lives, they stood up to resist her. So they understood that the church down in Rome was not good. It was not good. So they started to the Waldenses, they broke down what the Catholic Church did that was wrong. They talked about the wine and the bread. They talked about the mass, prayers to the dead. They called the prayers to the dead folly. They talked about purgatory. They said the Church of Rome is the apocalyptical whore of Babylon, that the Pope has no lawful primacy over the church or any title to both civil and ecclesiastical authority. And the vows of so they talked about there's nothing that Rome can do to them. They have no authority over them. They are free to worship and to choose to worship the way they want to. So the Antichrist, as defined in the dictionary, is a man mentioned in the New Testament as the enemy of Jesus, right? So the Waldensi, they identified the Antichrist way back, right? So what about the Reformers? Who did the Reformers say the Antichrist was? Martin Luther, papal tyranny. John Calvin, Roman pontiff. John Knox, the Pope. Roger Williams, the Pope. Charles Spurgeon, popery in the Church of Rome. Now these are all people that were part of the Reformation, the breaking away, the people that the Protestants that protested the Catholic Church. They all identified who the Antichrist was. And in our definition, the Antichrist is the enemy of Jesus, right? J.A. Wiley, and he's the one that authored the book that I bought that I read that's fascinating. The Roman Papacy. Ellen White, papacy. Now, I want to talk about something real quick. There, Satan uses two methods to get us to fall under the things that he wants us to do. He uses the feminine and the masculine approach. Now, the feminine approach is very soft and gentle. He will ask you very nicely, please do this, please do that. Really soft, really, you know, it's if you ever in retail, it's the soft sell. It's real easy. Oh, just look around. If you have any questions, let me know. The soft sell, real easy. And then there's the masculine. It's the forceful way, right? So Satan is either going to do it really gentle or he's going to do it really forceful. You do it or you're dead. That's the masculine way. So Satan always comes at you first, the feminine way, and second,